You're on.
Thank you.
Oh, You ready?
Do you feel the world is
broken? Good morning. Welcome to Country Bible Church. So glad you're here today. A couple of things to announce before we kick off with our call to worship. If you've got Wi-Fi on, please do us a favor and turn that off. That would be really helpful for the folks watching at home. We do have quite a few people who are watching the live stream at home, especially as, you know, things get a little bit weird here and there outside. We're glad that so many of you are here today, but also very glad that many of you decided to worship at home today. Pat, did you bring that box? Is that back there? Okay, awesome. So, in lieu of a shower for the Garlitz family and their incoming child, we're going to be dropping diapers in there as much as we can. There's a box there. You can drop those in for the next several weeks. They've still got some time before she's due to give birth. So, please do bring them some diapers and let's stock them up well. Pat, yes. Okay. If it's a big box of diapers, set it beside the box so you don't take up the space for everybody else who brings the small boxes of diapers. Okay. Got it. All right. Awesome. Yes. Another thing, Israel, if you're considering going, right now the trip is still on. If you want to put in a deposit, please feel free to do so. If you've been on the list for communications about that, you've probably gotten some communications about it recently. If you're tired of getting those and you know I'm not even going to go, let Tim Sloan know. He's with Kauffman Church of Christ and he'll get you off the list and you don't have to see those anymore. But if you do want to go, $400 is the deposit. It's completely refundable up to like 90 days out. And by that time, we will know, you know, a good idea of whether this is really going to happen or not. But it's a great time to sign up and to register because ticket prices for flights are ridiculously low relative to what they were. So the cost of the trip is quite a bit less. Okay, we're going to have a call to worship this morning from Psalm chapter 8, where the psalmist says, O Lord, our Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth. You have set your glory above the heavens. When I look at your heavens, the work of your fingers, the moon and the stars which you've set in place, what is man that you're mindful of him, or the son of man that you care for him? Yet you have made him a little lower than the heavenly beings and crowned him with glory and honor. O Lord, our Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth. Let's pray together. Father, as we come together to worship this morning, Father, we're overwhelmed by all that we've seen from you this past week and the times that we've spent, whether that be outside or inside or with people or however it might look. God, seeing technology and advances that are made, we see things as the psalmist saw the sun and the moon and the stars and proclaimed your handiwork and felt himself small. So as we approach you this morning, we too feel ourselves small at all that we've seen. And yet we know that you consider us, that you see us, you look upon us, you are pursuing us. You've called us into relationship with yourself. God, you have called us here this morning, whether to be here in this place in person or to gather with the people of God online. You have called us in. We have not come of our own accord, but you have brought us here, God. And so we pray that you would continue to draw us again and again by your grace and your mercy this morning. Lavish it upon your people, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Leads me to your goodness, helping me. true, whatever is noble, whatever is right and pure. If it is lovely, if it is admirable, excellent and praiseworthy. Whatever is true, whatever is noble, whatever is right and pure. If it is lovely, if it is admirable,
I want to live for you. guys get to see. Are you so thankful that even though you were once his enemy, now because of Christ and the great love with which God has for us and because of the gospel, that you are now adopted sons and daughters of Christ and you are seated at the table of Almighty God?
Amen.
Are you happy about that?
Amen.
That God is the lover of your soul. Oh God, we are thankful for his steadfast love. We want to take a time, some time here to pray for the things that you see in your bulletin. Most of you have a bulletin. We want to pray for the Genesis Center. Some of you may or may not know that Pastor Nancy has resigned from the Genesis Center and she's retiring. And so we want to pray for the Genesis Center and Alan Austin and them as they transition to however they're going to move through this. So just please pray for them during this transition. Alan also sent us a letter notifying us of Nancy's retirement, but also that because of the pandemic, people have been cleaning out their house. Maybe some of you have done that, and they have been bombarded in a good way with a lot of things for the thrift store, so he wanted to say thank you so much for that. So just please be in prayer for the Genesis Center. Also, I just want to say that this week we had a youth trip this week. Andrew affectionately referred to it about halfway through as Big Kid VBS. That's kind of what it felt like, really. But it was really, really good, guys. I mean, the students did a whole lot of work around the campus. I don't know if you can see some of the trees. A lot of the trees have been trimmed. Things have been painted and cleaned up. You've probably never seen the drums area, but because Max Terry's in charge of it, it was awful. But some of the youth cleaned that up, and it doesn't even look like the same thing. Max was like, I didn't realize the carpet was green back there. But the kids did a great job. My favorite thing of the whole week, though, was we asked three of our high schoolers to lead devotions throughout the day. And Max and James Nichols and Chris Clark led devotions, and I wish you guys could have heard them. They were really awesome. I appreciate that, guys. I appreciate you guys stepping up to the plate. I know you were nervous. But just they're older. They're high schoolers. And their knowledge of Scripture came out. Their conviction for their friends came out. Their desire to obey God and please God came out in those devotions. So thank you guys for that. I think it was really good for the younger Kaleo students to see that. It was great for the leaders to see that. So thank you guys so much for that. We did the D3 conference virtually, the D3 conference that Boyce College puts on out of Louisville. We've actually been to that conference physically twice. We were going to go again this time, but they did it virtually, which was really good. So that was a really good week. Appreciate you guys. And appreciate all of you guys for helping. A lot of you guys contributed food and money and effort, and so we appreciate that. I just want you to know it was a great week. I think it was profitable for the kids and for us, too. It was really, really good. If you see there in your bulletin, we just want to pray for these things. I want to add Richard Dominguez to this. A lot of you already know, but Richard tested positive for COVID. But Andrew showed me a picture that he put on Facebook, one of his cartoons of himself running. And he said, now that I'm done with COVID, I'm ready to go. And his cat, who I guess speaks English, says, where are we going? And Richard says, I don't know, but we're going. So it sounds like he's doing well. But please continue to pray for him and Debbie as they move on from that. We want to continue to lift up Ursula's dad, also Mike and Ursula and Lexi and Andy as they moved in with them. So please keep them in your prayers. Abe is continuing to get good reports, right? So we're moving forward with that. Hopefully in July, we may see the brace come off, right? So that's good. Please continue to pray for them. The friend of the Fortners, Roberta, she is recuperating, but she's going to be having this biopsy on the mass that they discovered. So please be in prayer for them. The friend of the Mandronis family had the hysterectomy, but the surgery went successful, the post-hysterectomy surgery. So we praise God for that. Sue's sister-in-law, Holiday, she's recovering from a successful surgery from the previous hysterectomy also. So just please continue to pray for her. Grace's nephew, which I guess is probably 4 months old now or five, cerebral palsy, partial brain damage. Should please be in prayer for that family. Michelle had a great surgery. James did. They're recovering well. Jerry, if you've seen Jerry, a lot of you have taken Jerry to his radiation treatments, and that's a treat. If you haven't done it, you need to do it. And so Jerry also is having, because of his lung cancer, he's struggling with his voice. And so he's going to be visiting a speech therapist in July. So please pray for the speech therapist. And also for Jerry, as they watch. Right? So Jerry's in rare form right now. But we want to pray for Jerry as he walks through that in Marchez. Also, Rachel Rogers' friend Lucas Green's been diagnosed with leukemia. Please pray for that. As we go to God in prayer, I want to read something that Al Mohler reminded us of this week at the youth conference. It's a passage you know well. It's a passage out of Romans, the end of Romans 11. But as we approach God, with our prayers for these things, it's important for us to approach God believing that he hears us instead of us just saying some words in our head. That God hears the prayer of his people. Listen to what Paul says in Romans 11. Paul says, "Oh, the depth of the riches and wisdom and knowledge of God. How unsearchable are his judgments, and how inscrutable are his ways. For who has known the mind of the Lord? Or who has been his counselor? Or who has given a gift to him that he might be repaid? For from God and through God and to God are all things. To God be glory forever and ever. Amen." So as we go to God and remember this, that how deep are the riches and wisdom and knowledge of God? How deep is his knowledge of each of these things? More than you know. So let's go to God, believing that he hears our prayers, and pray for these things. God, today we come to you and we, God, we believe that you hear the cries of your people. All throughout your scripture, God, there are people crying out to you and you answering prayers, you hearing them. So God, this morning as we approach you on behalf of these people, God, we say that we agree with your scripture. And we say, oh, the depths of the riches and wisdom and knowledge of God. God, we know that you are keenly aware of every one of these circumstances that we pray for. And so, God, we're just really just voicing that you would accomplish your will within these people's lives. God, that you would accomplish your ways. Really, that's our prayer. God, we pray for the Genesis Center as they do have this transition. We pray for Nancy as she transitions into retirement. God, we thank you for all of the donations that have been made. And God, please be with Alan and the board. And as they seek to replace Nancy, God, I pray that you would be with them in that process and prepare a person for that role in the Genesis Center. God, we pray for Ursula's mom and dad. As they're walking through this difficult time, God, I pray for belief on their part that they would remember, God, that you are in control, especially in the hardest of times. And I pray for Mike and Ursula and Lexi and Andy. God, as they all are living together in this time. God, I pray that the truth of your word would dominate that house. God, that truth would surround that house about your goodness. God, we thank you so much for Abe and the healing that you've done in his neck. And God, we pray for good reports in July so that he'll be able to get rid of that brace. We pray for Roberta Garrett, God, that you would be with her as she has the biopsy on the kidney and the mass in there. God, we pray for a favorable result for her and that you would be with her through this. God, Melissa, the Mandronis' family, pray for her that she would continue to heal from the hysterectomy. And God, as she goes through chemo, God, be with her and help her to remember that you are in control. For Sue's sister-in-law, Holiday, pray that she would continue to heal from her surgery. For Grace's young nephew, God, we pray for him and his family. God, we pray for peace for that family. God, we pray for hope for that family. We pray for comfort for that family, God, and that people would surround them with your with prayers. God, that people would surround them with encouragement and hope. God, we thank you for Michelle's surgery and James' surgery and the success of those surgeries, God, that they're recovering well. God, we pray for Jerry and Marchez as they continue to walk through this lung cancer. We pray for his speech therapy appointments next month, God, that those that he would see, that they would be profitable for him, that he would see results in his voice, because I know that's frustrating to him right now, God. So just please heal his voice and be with him as he continues to go through radiation. And God, for Lucas Green, who's been diagnosed with leukemia, God, we just pray for him as he goes through chemo. God, that he would know that you're in control and that he would believe in your ways. God, we thank you for that we can come to you, that we can pray over these things, that we can pray for the things in our life that are going on, and that you hear our prayers. You got someone said one time that the praying life is not for the disciplined, but for the desperate. And God, we approach you, God, desperate for you to move in our life, desperate for you to move in these lives. And God, we thank you that we came to you as sinners, hopeless and desperate, but God, because of your great love, you saved us. Oh God, we thank you for the gospel, that we can come to you and that we can speak your name, that we can speak your name on behalf of these people. Oh God, we thank you for the cross of Jesus and his empty tomb. Without that, God, all of this is a moot point. So God, we lift up your name. God, we lift up your name as high as we can today. We thank you for your love. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Waiting arms. Amen. Amen. Philippians chapter 4. Turn with me there today. A short passage with a whole lot to it. Begin in verse 8. Where Paul writes, "Finally, brothers, whatever is true, whatever is honorable, whatever is just, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is commendable, if there is any excellence, if there's anything worthy of praise, think about these things. What you have learned and received and heard and seen in me, practice these things, and the God of peace will be with you." I have never been to the Alps, but if you were to explain them to me, say you had been there, maybe the Phillips could explain the Alps to me. And I like the sound of them. They talk about them enough. I could picture them in my brain. And I would know, I want to be in the presence of the Alps someday, just by their description. Pretty sure. But what if there were another way for me to know more about them than just the words that Phillips used to describe it? Would I take it? Would I take that other way? Yeah, I would. If you would say, if they would actually get out and paint me a picture of the Alps, I could see some of the things that were described to me with words in a whole new light, right? I would understand and appreciate the Alps even more and be able to talk about them better than before I hadn't seen any sort of picture of them, just heard about them. Now, this painting of the Alps that they're painting for me, that's not the Alps, right? It's not the mountain range, of course, it's a painting of them. Nor does it really add anything new to the Alps, this painting. But man, that painting would sure help me see those beautiful mountains for what they really are. In a similar way, we have the Word of God. It tells us what it means to be a follower of Jesus, to believe the gospel, to walk according to Christ's ways, God's will, His way. And God's Word is sufficient. We proclaim that here. But what if there's another way for us to know more about what it means to follow Jesus? Would we take it? Now, before you think, oh my gosh, he's about to talk about a whole new, you know, scripture or something. That's not where I'm going with this. No, if God were to paint us a picture of the same things that he's told us in his word, we'd see those things described in a whole new light, right? Things that we just read before. We would understand and we'd apply his truth even better. And we'd be able to talk about it a whole lot better than if we hadn't seen that picture he had painted. Now, again, the picture that he's painting of the word of Scripture is not the word itself. Nor would that painting, if God were to paint it, add anything new to the word, for nothing new can be added to it. But it would sure help us see the word in an enlightening sort of way for what it is. Friends, God has indeed painted that picture. And he's painted it again and again. He's adding to it every day. He's adding to it by causing humanity to create and produce new things full of goodness and full of beauty. He's adding to it by advancing technologies that give us new understanding of God's truth. He's adding to it by transforming the people of God in their hearts and in their minds such that we have each other to watch, to learn from. These things, they're not the Word, nor do they add new revelation to the Word. No. But we might call them gracious supplements to God's Word, if you will. They are gifts of grace to us to heighten our understanding of God and His truth. They are not vital, not by any stretch. Meaning without them, without these things that we're going to see and talk about today, we're still able to know and understand God and follow Jesus without them. If we were completely left without the pictures. But man, they are certainly beneficial to our walks with God. Such that we would be fools to ignore them. To ignore the pictures that God is painting. The Word is our guide for life, for mission. But how do we know what the word is pointing us to be and do without getting glimpses of it in our world? Well, for one, we look at Jesus, the description of Christ in the word. Absolutely, we'll talk about that. But even what we read of Jesus, we only have the ability to picture and interpret based on what we see around us today. For instance, if the Bible describes Jesus standing next to a tree, I know what a tree is because I've seen one before. God's word is how we interpret our world, not vice versa. Very important. But our world can help us better understand, appreciate, and apply the word. And it would be a shame to waste opportunities to better understand, appreciate, and apply the word by ignoring the pictures that God is painting around us. Yet historically, many Christians have done that very thing. In our desire to protect the word as all-sufficient, which it absolutely is, we have decided we won't look to anything else to teach us about God. So maybe we retreat to a monastery. We don't see anything else. We can just put our faces in the book all day. Or we have boycotts of certain things. We're not going to go anywhere near said whatever it is, because golly. If we cut ourselves off, we think, from anything that is potentially contrary to God in our world, then we'll be closer to God. We'll be free from temptation. We will be following Jesus more rightly. And yet history shows us that in the church, that method has by and large failed us. That maybe rather by keeping our eyes open to what's around us and not hiding from it all or retreating from it all, that there's better opportunity there for us to better visualize the life God has described for us in his word and then to live it out. So, first of all today, don't ignore the pictures God is painting in your world. Don't ignore the pictures God is painting in your world. Friends, you can see biblical virtues in all true and honorable, etc., etc., pieces of our culture. You can see it. That will help you better understand what the Bible is describing for your life lived in Christ. Recently read a book called 1491. It's a book about how the Americas were before Columbus arrived. Great book. I ended up reading the follow-up, much to my wife's annoyance. She just hates that I'm just sitting there reading a book about history, but I'm doing it. But interwoven throughout this kind of scholarly work of history, there are pictures. Pictures of old paintings that people have painted from that era. New pictures from what the landscape is like today. And those pictures are really helpful for me because they give me a better understanding of the words that I'm reading. I'm not embarrassed that I like pictures in my books. It's fine. You can do that. Paul called the Philippians to think. Yes, this is weird, but listen. He called the Philippians to think on things of the world. Verse 8 again. Finally, brothers, whatever is true, whatever is honorable, whatever is just, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is commendable, if there's any excellence, if there's anything worthy of praise, think about these things. Now, when I say Paul called the Philippians to think on things of the world, I'm not meaning world in a fleshly negative sense, of course. I mean world in the all that's around you kind of sense. Whatever, whatever, anything, anything. He called them to seek out and stare at the best of the best in the world. That's what Paul's doing here. What is pure and lovely and commendable isn't limited to just what we find in the pages of Scripture. Now, that seems to kind of contradict what we said a couple of weeks ago from chapter 3, verse 19, where I talked about getting a crick in your neck, right? Remember 3:19? Go back and let's look at it. Where he was describing kind of enemies of the cross of Christ, and he said, their end is destruction, their God is their belly, and they glory in their shame with minds set on earthly things. And so you're thinking, well, this completely goes against what you talked about then. But it's not. It's not contradictory, believe it or not. For one, there's a difference between having minds set on earthly things, fixated And actually, we talked about looking down, right? That fixated on those things versus never looking up. There's a difference between that and simply looking around at them, seeing them. For another, earthly things, like Paul was talking about in chapter 3, verse 19, those are most certainly things that are worldly in that negative fleshly sense. Worldly from our culture, meaning not contributing to drawing you nearer to God, but actually pulling you away from Him, which is not what Paul is talking about here for the Philippians to look at. He's directing them to look at the best of the best in the world. Now, the dominating philosophy of the day was Greek, right? It was a Roman world. Rome had conquered the Greek Empire, but they were still really living in Greek thought, because that's what the Romans did. They just stole from whoever they took from. The Greek philosophy of the time was all about virtue. It's all about virtue. Now, virtues are the highest of moral standards, right? And so the Greeks said, what is the most virtuous that a person could possibly be? Find that and pursue it. That's what they said. Now, the Greeks didn't always get virtue right, but they were definitely on to something. Many scholars believe that Paul was playing off of that philosophy here in Philippians chapter 4. That this was a list of virtues that the culture outside the church at the time was actually in pursuit of. And that he's essentially saying to the Philippians, you guys know what's virtuous. You know it. You knew it when you were unbelievers. You knew it was virtuous. You have already pursued moral excellence and virtue, but you've done it imperfectly, incompletely, because it's been devoid of Jesus, who's the embodiment of virtue. And apart from the Word, which is the foundation for discovering and measuring virtue. And then he's saying, now that you're following Jesus and your heart has been changed, take that good but lacking understanding of morality and virtue that you've had and show the world that Christians get right. Now keep in mind that the Philippians likely had very little scripture to go off of to learn what it meant to follow this Christ that they put their faith in. Like, how do we do it? I don't know. Where do we go? If only we had a book to look at. Well, they didn't really have that, right? Now, the Old Testament picture, if they were given some scrolls and parchments of the Old Testament, that was fuzzy for them at best to read through. And, well, how does that tell me how to live for Jesus? They struggled with that, I think. We don't know how much they even had access to begin with, or how much they would have understood it. They were Gentiles, for the most part. They didn't really know Jewish history. Now, they did get oral gospel accounts, right, to hear about who Jesus was so they could emulate him. They heard again and again, this was Jesus, this is who we want to be like, this is who God is making us into. They may or may not have had other uninspired letters from Paul or maybe other apostles to read and learn. And so Paul is pointing out, hey, you may not have all this, but there is a lot around you in the world that will help you see and understand what it means to pursue God. There have been many pictures painted for you. Anything about the culture the Philippians lived in that was true, or honorable, or just, or pure, etc., anything like that ultimately came from God. Because He is the source of all loveliness. He is the source of all excellence. He is the source of anything worthy of praise. And thus there was much that they could learn from observing things in the world that were full of virtues that ultimately came from God. Now, it was tricky. The trick was to locate those virtues, the ones he's talking about, that were clearly Christ-like, and to set their minds toward those, over and against all of the non-virtues, which their culture was also very much infiltrated with. And the culture was trying to convince the Philippians, these are virtuous things too. Certainly they weren't, according to Christ. We are called, friends, to think on things of the world. It's weird to say, but of course I don't mean in a negative fleshly sense. We are to seek out and stare at, observe, look at the best of the best in our world. That's what Paul's talking about. Now, that doesn't contradict, again, what we said in back in 3:19. We don't have our minds set, fixated to where we never are drawn upward, right? On earthly things. What we're looking for as we look around our world are the nuggets of goodness and beauty that draw us nearer to God, further illuminating what he's told us in his word, not those things that push us further from him in our hearts and minds. Maybe it's just reading truth in a good book. Maybe it's seeing justice played out in an excellent movie. Maybe it's seeing honor displayed in a comic strip. Unlike the Philippians, we have the whole of the scriptures, right, to learn what it means to follow Christ. We've got them, praise God. And yet there is much around us in our world that can help us better see and understand what it means to pursue him. Many pictures that have been painted. Our world, in this way, it's kind of like a museum. Now, I like that. Some of you are like, oh, don't tell me that because that stinks. But I like museums. But our world is like that. It's like a museum that hosts all of the absolutely finest works there are. God himself has painted goodness and loveliness and beauty and excellence into each one of those works. And we can go into this museum that is all around us, and we can stand and we can peruse gorgeous pictures of things. Pictures of virtue. That until we had seen them painted, we had only read them as described in words. We can see honor in that picture over there. Oh, we can really identify justice in that picture over there. Oh, that's excellence in that picture there. We set our minds to the best of what we see and so become formed by them and into them. And that's a good thing. That's a good thing. Even though they are earthly, if you will, things. Why is that a good thing? Because anything in our culture that is true or honorable or just or pure, and the list goes on, ultimately comes from God. God is the source of all loveliness and excellence and praiseworthiness. The church father, Justin Martyr, writing just a little bit after the Philippians, was kind of commenting on this very thing, and he said this: the truth, which men in all lands have rightly spoken, belongs to us. He's saying, whatever anybody else has said in the world, these people who are pagans, but if it's true and they've said it, it belongs to us because it comes from God. Ultimately, it's true. The 19th century Dutch theologian Abraham Kuyper wrote, there is not a square inch in the whole domain of our human existence over which Christ, who is sovereign over of all, does not cry, mine. Whatever is true, whatever is lovely, whatever is admirable, Christ says, that's mine. It's mine. The truth in a good book, the justice in that excellent film, the beauty that you hear in a simple love song. So you see, there is much that we can learn from meditating on the things in the world that we see because they are full of virtues that ultimately come from God. The trick, though, there is a trick here, is to locate those virtues, which is why Paul gives us a nice little list to go with, to locate those virtues and set our minds to those versus the non-virtues that the world is also infiltrated with, of course, that are trying to pull us away from God, that the world's trying to convince us are good and worthy virtues, which of course they are not. This is why 2 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 5 says that we must take every thought captive. Takes work to do this, to live this way. It's easier, frankly, to live in a monastery. It's easier to boycott everything that has potential negative consequences on our thought life. Are you studying the world around you? Again, not fixating on the world. There's a difference, and you know that. But are you taking things in? Oh, friends, there's so much to take in here. Books and music and movies and nature and hobbies and food. But it means more than just taking those things in. It means more than just consuming these things. It means taking them in with purpose. I like books like this. I think I've mentioned this one before. Karen Swallow Pryor wrote On Reading Well. And what she does here, the subtitle, Finding the Good Life Through Great Books. So she goes back through world literature, and each chapter praises a virtue. So she's digging into literature and trying to find, okay, what's the best, the most beautiful, the most lovely and excellent thing from there that Christ cries, that's mine. Let's find that. Focus on it. It's a good approach. To find what is true and just and pure in all of these things, that's our charge. And then to set our minds. He says, think on them. Think on them. Don't just see them and then walk away from them. It seems to me that this list, kind of put this in air quotes, this list of things, right? True, honorable, just, pure, lovely, commendable, excellent, praiseworthy. It's really just describing one big concept. It's one big concept. What? It's the overarching goodness of God in creation as he intended it. Genesis says he looked at it, he saw it, and it was very good. And that goodness still, it still sits beneath the brokenness, the marred ugliness that has infiltrated our world because of sin. There's goodness there to see. And you see it in purity. You see it in justice, loveliness. Such that you don't have to go down this list. Like, you don't have to make yourself a bookmark with all these things and list it off and say, is that a pure thing? Or is that one a commendable thing? No, it's one thing that you know every time you're considering, should I meditate on this? Should I think on this? Should I put myself before this, whatever it is I'm seeing? It fits in the goodness of God. You should just know, based on the whole counsel of God, whether what you are considering, what you are consuming, what you're taking in is worthwhile or not. How about right now, in this very kind of unique era we're in, there is something, I've said this once, I'm going to say it probably a couple more times, there is something that you can learn from everyone and everything, even those that you disagree with. You have to approach what you're seeing, what you're observing, with the willingness to learn. Otherwise, you do not grow. You do not grow. You have more opportunity now, during this time, believe it or not, to think on things than you have before. I hope that's been a part of your quarantine experience, thinking a little bit more, observing, studying the pictures that God has painted. Now, I repeat, studying the pictures doesn't replace immersing yourself in this word. Please don't hear me saying that. It should never cause you either to question the truth of this word. What you see out there will not contradict what is in here, if rightly understood. But studying the pictures of Christ-like virtue in your world does give some dimension to the Bible's description of Christ-likeness. That will help you understand it and live it out. Don't ignore the pictures God is painting in your world. And second, don't ignore the pictures God is painting in your church. In your church, you can see the practicality of your theology lived out in the lives of other believers who teach you and show you. They show you, and it helps you better understand what the Bible is describing for your life lived in Christ. You ever tried to describe an idea that you're having to someone that you're with, like, man, I have this really good idea, and I'm just describing, just going, and they're sitting there and not really understanding it, and finally you just say, just let me draw you a picture. And you draw out a little diagram, and it just, boom, it just makes complete sense to them. Got the napkin out, and there it is. Paul called the Philippians to watch him, to learn and do the same. Verse 9. What you have learned and received and heard and seen in me, practice these things, and the God of peace will be with you. Now, we've already seen that he's mentioned also in this letter, watching others in the church and learning from them too, right? And here he says, what you've learned and received and heard and seen, there is an intentionally rhythmic cadence of these verbs. I'm hammering everything home for you, Philippians. Paul taught them and modeled Christ following for them. He was a picture himself that God was painting for the Philippians to see and better understand the word that he was preaching to them, to see it practiced. How gracious of God to accompany the truth that the Philippians were being taught with a living, breathing example of it. Isn't that good of God? Paul, just imagine Paul preaching this and writing this, distributing it, going place to place, and never living it. Just not helpful. Very difficult, in fact, for the Philippians then. But he did live it. Now, we've mentioned that the dominating philosophy of the day was Greek, right? And how Christians could see good things even from pagan sources. But now, think about how Paul would have been a picture of a different sort. He would have been a picture of counter-cultural lifestyle to many of the errors of Greek thought. The untrue, the dishonorable, the unlovely parts of the world. Paul's life provided a contrast against that. So that when he preached to them, he went to the Philippians and he preached, or he wrote something like, let your reasonableness be known to all. We talked about his gentleness. When he said, hey, be gentle, Philippians. When he said that, while the Greeks over here prized coarseness and winning debates, no matter what the cost, over kindness and gentleness, the Philippians would see that, but they would have also seen the right way to live in Paul. The gentle way, and be able to say, ah, yes, we know, we've seen the contrast, we know what that looks like, we know what he's saying, because we've seen the picture of gentleness, of reasonableness. We haven't seen it in our culture, but we have seen it in this believer who's been transformed by the gospel of God. You can see how then these two things really fit well together and provide some very good balance for the Philippians. If they only had a steady diet of observing virtue in the world, man, they'd very much be missing out on a whole bunch of helpful correctives provided them by looking closely at their fellow believers whose hearts were being formed and shaped by the gospel. Both were good. Both were good. Again, in that day, seeing the faith, think about this, in the Philippians' day, seeing the faith lived out by another Christian was often the only way a newborn church would ever know how to live like a Christian. It's often the only way. Paul and Epaphroditus and Timothy were some of the only pictures the Philippians had of what they were being taught. These four verbs show that the Philippians had gotten every single display that they needed of what Christ-like character was, in order to be able to soak it in and then imitate it. They could not make the excuse, well, we weren't sure how exactly how to do this whole Christ-following thing. We just didn't really have a picture. You wrote to us about it, but we couldn't really understand it. Now they could. You've heard it. You've seen it. You've received it. You've been there. Other believers had been living it out right before their eyes. We are called to watch other believers and to emulate them. You're called to this church. Learned and received and heard and seen It's not enough, friends, just to be taught. It is not enough just to be taught. Sermons, like the one I'm giving right now, they are insufficient in of themselves. Same for Bible studies and Sunday schools and Bible college classes. Insufficient. You've got to have models of Christ following in your life. Gotta have them. And they are here in your church if you will take the time to be near them and watch them closely in their lives. There are pictures here that God has painted for you to better understand what the word you're hearing preached means for you practically. How gracious of God to accompany that truth that you're being taught with living, breathing examples of it. There is much that you can learn by digging for what's lovely and praiseworthy and excellent in the world. So much you can learn. But think about how your brothers and sisters in Christ provide a picture of countercultural lifestyle over and against the many errors of our culture today. You need that too. A contrast to the untrue, to the dishonorable, to the unlovely parts of the world. Their lives provide a contrast against that for you to see. So that when you hear things from the pulpit, like we did several weeks ago, like, consider others more important than yourself. You're like, okay, all right. While our culture, if you're just looking at our culture, it prizes what? Getting ahead by any means possible, looking out for number one. But you hear that, and you say, whoa, I recognize that I have seen this. I've seen the right way, in contrast to my culture, of how to live, because I've seen it in my fellow gospel partners who are with me in this. And I'm able to say then, I know just what that looks like. I've seen someone else consider another more important than themselves. I haven't seen it in my world so much, but I've seen it in my church. These two things fit so well together, provide us so much balance. Okay, if you only have a steady diet of observing virtue in your world, you will be missing out on a whole bunch of helpful correctives provided you if you would look closely at your fellow believers whose hearts are being formed and shaped by the gospel of God, even at this very moment. Yes, unlike the Philippians, we have the whole of the scriptures. We have the whole of the scriptures to go off of to learn what it means to follow Christ. That is a blessing, friends. Immerse yourself in this word. Do it. And yet there is much around us in our fellow believers that can help us see and help us understand what it means to pursue Jesus the way that the word directs us to. Many pictures God has painted. God is the one who has painted goodness and loveliness and praiseworthiness into each of your lives. The church, too, is like a museum where we can go and stand and peruse these gorgeous pictures of things that until we had seen them in action, we had only heard about them, read about them with words. Like the Alps. We see honor here. We see justice there. We see excellence there. Once we'd only read about those things, but now we know. Now we've seen the pictures. Example. My mom dug this out a while back when she was cleaning some things out. This is a note. It's pretty cool. It's got dinosaurs and palm trees on it. I was given this note, I believe, when I was probably 5 or 6 years old. And it was from a church member. Her name is Karen Hines. And it says this. I know you like dinosaurs, so I wanted to send this to you. We sure do think you are a great guy. We are very thankful we get to be your friend. You know, God talks a lot about friendship in the Bible and how very special it is. Proverbs 17:17 says, a friend loves at all times. That means we love each other in good times and bad times. It's nice to have people care about you and know people will be there in every situation. God is faithful like that too. He is always with us and he loves us in the good times and the bad times. He cares very much for you, Matthew. I'm sure he has a very, very special plan for your life. It will be fun for you to discover what God has in store for you each day. I encourage you to trust him more and more and allow him to have first place in your life. This is a good opportunity to tell you the qualities I've seen in your life that the Lord has really blessed you with. Generosity, a loving, fun-filled spirit, friendliness, intelligence, leadership, and a great sense of humor. I pray you will always use these things to bring honor to the Lord. You are truly so special. Love, Mark, Karen, Ben, and Aaron. Your people are pictures for you to see and to imitate. Karen taught me those things, and then she lived them out right in front of my face. We watch believers like this, maybe for 30 years, who we know are seeking the Lord closely, and we become formed by them and formed into them as they are being formed by and into Christ. We can do this because anything about our brothers and sisters that is true or honorable or pure, anything you found in here that fits that list, which is probably every single bit of it, it ultimately comes from God. That's Christ in her, it's not her. God is the source of all loveliness and excellence and praiseworthiness in any of your gospel partners. So my question to you is, are you watching anyone closely in this body? Or do you kind of look around and you think, gosh, there's really no one for me to learn from because, frankly, they should be learning from me. This means you got to be around the body of Christ. Obviously increasingly difficult right now. I hope that you've seen how much isolation eats away at this opportunity. It should make you, this time, friends, should make you long to be near other believers who can be for you the pictures of godliness that you need. When this is all over, if you're still apathetic about community, you will have missed a massive part of what God has been trying to teach you all along. So what about right now? I don't know exactly, but I know it's going to take a lot of extra intentionality for you during this time because we aren't getting to see each other as much, walking our walks, if you will, right now. You're going to have to figure that out. It's going to take some work. But there's so much you can learn from your fellow believers. Even the ones that you disagree with. There might be a lot of disagreement during this time. You can still learn. You can still watch. You have to approach what you see in each other. We have to approach what we see in each other with the willingness to learn from it. Otherwise, we're not going to grow. It's not enough just to see it. It's to be ready to learn from it. Observe, friends, and study the pictures that God has painted. Learn it and do the same. Again, I repeat, studying the pictures does not replace immersing yourself in the Word, but studying the pictures of Christ-like virtue. Studying this, I've read this note a lot of times in the past couple of years since she found it. Studying it helps you see Christ-like virtue in another, and it gives dimension, gives real dimension, flesh and bones, to the Bible's description of Christ's likeness that was once for you just kind of words It's going to help you understand it better. It's going to help you live it out. Don't ignore the pictures God is painting in your church. Ultimately, all that we're setting our minds to, all that we are watching closely in the world, in our church, is worthy of us doing so. Why? Because it points us to Jesus, in whom all the good and the true and the lovely finds its goodness and trueness and loveliness. All virtue, all morality finds its value, its worth in Christ. Without Jesus, there is no virtue. Without Jesus, there is no morality. There is no godliness or Christ-likeness to pursue. He is the incarnation of this word. Everything else leads back to him. Anything we see in our world that is praiseworthy, anything we see in our brothers and sisters that is commendable, they are only so because they lead us to him. And at the same time, all that we see in those pictures, in the world, in the church, all of it falls short of perfect justice and truth and purity and loveliness. It all falls short, doesn't it? You know that. There's a little bit of emptiness in you, even when you see it. Because nothing in the world displays Philippians 4:8 rightly at any point. No one in our church displays Philippians 4:8 rightly in any stretch. And so all the watching and all the learning and all the observing we do is ultimately meant to create in us a longing for the perfection of Philippians 4:8, which is Christ. He alone is to us truth and honor and justice and purity and love. He alone is worthy of highest praise. So may all of our intent staring at God's gracious pictures lead us in our hearts and minds back to him. Let's pray together. Oh God, do lead us. There we pray. As we look and on whatever is true and whatever is noble and whatever is right and pure, if it's lovely and if it's admirable, if it's excellent and praiseworthy and we think on it, may we recognize its incompleteness and imperfection to reach those virtues that are ultimately only had and valued and perfected in Christ Jesus. We want to be pointed to him, O God. So point us again and again. Open our eyes to see the pictures that you've painted for us, Lord. And then to see, as great as those things are, as much as you teach us through them, oh, but Jesus is better. In his name we pray. Amen. And We will dismiss from the back. This side goes out to that aisle, and this side goes out to the middle aisle, one row at a time from the back. If you have offering today, we've got a couple of boxes in the back. You can drop your offering there. If you're at home, there are lots of ways that you can give online on our website. There's a link, or you can mail it or come by the office. We are here. So glad to be with y'all today. It is absolutely a pleasure to worship in the house of God. Let's close with a benediction. May the Lord continually open your eyes to see the goodness and truth and beauty of the world around you and close by in those who are near you in the body of Christ, as he transforms you to be more like his Son, to the praise of his glorious grace. Go in him, in Jesus' name, amen.
Do you wish that you could see it all?